those little regions that are colored, this shows that across different individuals of the same species, it can be variable regions, and you can stitch these regions together. You'll notice most in black here, most of the DNA is the same shared across, right? This is where that 99.99% is alike, but the differences are what we can key on. We can start to say, all right, peoples from this region or peoples that survived this disease over here, they have more of these SNPs in common. They're more closely related. Equally, you can just find out who's straight up more related. This takes us back to the beginning of class where it's like, you're about 50-50 like your brother or sister, about 50-50 like your parents. And that's gonna cut in half every time you go up a generation or across a generation. We have the tools now to say that there are variable either or regions sometimes that can help us define human populations or any species populations for that matter. Now, you can also use protein. Protein changes are different than SNPs because technically they can be acted on. They are going to affect the thing we're after, but you can still see that key changes happen between species. So looking at this last common ancestor 6 million years ago, it's a long time, so don't let the unholy feelings inside of you well up too hard. Don't worry. When you can see there are changes that are in the human genome that code for protein differences. Those are all our little proteins, remember? These are all differences over here between the two of our close cousins from that last common ancestor, chimpanzees and bonobos. And each of them have their own divergence as well. So it's data like these that you can use to say, all right, who's more closely related to who? Just another look at everything else. So something called an outgroup is pretty important. An outgroup is a member, a close cousin, but not in the immediate family that we are looking at, because the outgroup will show us what was even older than the family. So notice the region in question is a T or a G. Humans have a T, chimpanzees have a G. The outgroup, the other close related one, also has a G, which means we can infer that the human's T was evolved in just us, that it was unique to us. Because it was not here, wasn't here, and it wasn't here. And actually, we're inferring this one based on orangutan in this case. So using outgroups is a very quick way for us to say, all right, where did this change? When did it pop up? Which divergence did it have to happen beforehand? Because otherwise, if it had happened at this point, you'd expect chimpanzees to also have that T. They don't. So phylogenies, genomics, they can tell us what's unique about us in a lot of cases. Another thing that happens with us, and obviously this is kind of review, it's a nice friendly little image. We have quite a bit in common with the coding DNA that we have with our cousin species, but we have very much dissimilar in the manner of structural buildup of our chromosomes. We have lost significant regions compared to them. We've duplicated significant regions. We have tons of translocations compared to them. We have a lot of inversions too. So this is why when you sequence the genome and you find the order, yeah, it's still pretty close to the same thing, right? We still find the same similar regions. That's where that 95% comes from. When in fact, it's more about 70% actually true reading, no issues. One of the key ones here, I think we highlighted this before. One of the key differences between the human, the chimpanzee and bonobo setup of genes is that our chromosome 2 is a fusion of two of theirs. This was the first time before we could sequence, we could only stare at chromosomes and karyotypes in a microscope and say, there's just one difference. One big one that we can see with the naked eye. And at first everybody was like, well, somewhere in that chromosome lies the key to us, key to humans, to Homo sapiens, our talent, whatever it is. We have something else. You guys sequenced this in lab. ALU, our jumping gene, human jumping gene. It is more enriched in us than any other mammal species. And like we've spoken about with transposons, these little jumping viruses, 6 million years is not enough time to mutate us enough to be this different. But enough regions that you interfere with these little pockets of DNA, can be enough. Just think about all the possibilities. You can silence promoters, you can silence enhancers, so you can dose genes up. You can silence repressor or operator regions, right? You can straight up destroy genes, because if this goes in the middle of something, it's just boom, and there's just this nasty like pocket of, you know, 60 amino acids, ruins the gene. So anytime this random segment can come in, usually ruins stuff. It's not always the case though. ALU is unique because technically its reading can be done in frame. What I mean by that is when this inserts, remember how it's read like 3 by 3 by 3? ALU will typically not cause frame shifts, which means that if it gets inserted, it'll actually end up coding a little bit, which for whatever reason, sometimes doesn't kill off the gene, rarely, but it's a level of variation that's unique with ALU. We also find most of our regulatory regions of our brain have a lot more ALU enrichment than you would expect in a mammal as well. Transposon interference in that nature. So, phylogeny. There's us at the top, Homo sapiens. There's our cousin, chimpanzee, hooray. What this is meant to do, and what I always like to show with this, is we are quite still very far apart from our closest cousin in a chimp, okay? And also remember, bonobos are over here too. Let's put them as little b. So there existed nothing. None of this tree existed 6 million years ago. But the inference is that some sort of primate-like animal did at this point. There was always a lot of talk of like, there's a missing link. Oh no, what are we gonna do? When I was a kid in the 90s and there were shows about it and like, oh no, like, we don't know enough. And then they found Lucy's bones. That's the little Australopithecus in the middle there. Count her as that link. She was bipedal, but small. Still had the bones that it takes to climb trees, but didn't need to because they spent a lot more time on the plains. The inference with what we know from the climate in Africa is that jungles started to get kind of dried out by savannas, and it made more sense to go out into the plains than it did to stay in the jungle. Plains were a unique niche. Little Australopithecus like Lucy made the best out of that. Notice here too, and we'll get to this story, like I said, if you don't make it present day, it means you're gone in a phylogeny as well. So note that when we are looking at things. Okay. So as far as last common ancestor goes, we have only two things to actually look at what that might have looked like, that last common ancestor. On the left are chimps, on the right are bonobos. So it's sort of a, when you draw phylogenies, it's tough because on one hand you could say, well, maybe here's chimps and here's bonobos. And the way you can draw phylogeny can say like, well, like there was a splinter off of a species or there was a complete split in both directions. There's two different ways to draw it. I'm not gonna get it onto this on the exam or anything. What I'm asking you to consider is, if that 5 million years ago last common ancestor, what do you think they were like? Because bonobos are quite a bit more like humans. You ever seen a full like R-rated documentary on chimpanzees? It's not fun. They're not very nice to each other, okay? Bonobos solve a lot more problems through sociability, cooperation. Chimps don't. Keep this in mind as we kind of, we're gonna finish this part of this class on a principle based on these ideas. Now, as far as sequencing goes, predominating hypothesis out of Africa. Homo erectus was the main species that would dominate throughout of Africa for about, I would say about 1.5 million years, maybe about a million years ago. So, cool thing with The climate in Africa is that you need to keep moving. There's no place to just sit, okay? You need to keep moving, you need to keep following stuff. That means that there's a lot of gene flow actually in Homo erectus, pretty healthy species as far as we could tell. They don't have any dying events as you would imagine. Prevailing theory is that there were, and not even prevailing theory, I mean, it'd be hard to say this isn't the way that it happened. Let's just put it that way. About 100,000 years ago, there was a crossing event from Africa into the Fertile Crescent, what we know now is like kind of Egypt, Middle East. Those populations would then spread throughout the continents. You would maintain diverse populations in Africa. And so all these peoples, all these Homo sapiens, this is our jettison point, basically. There was a split after those that left Africa. Those that left Africa would become Neanderthals and Denisovans. So the original common ancestor between all three of us was about 750K years ago. Here's the crossing into the Fertile Crescent, and then populations migrated and split. Those populations would go on to become Neanderthal and Denisovan. Denisovans occupying more of Indonesia and those island regions. Neanderthals occupying more of the Fertile Crescent itself and Europe. So this event was distinct from Homo sapiens making this cross. This was early. This is not us. Homo sapiens actually have not arrived on the scene yet in this case. So, given this, we were on sort of a hunt for genetics. We had sequenced the human genome. So throughout the 90s, everybody was like, well, we want to sequence the Neanderthal genome. Because not only would you obviously learn tons from that, but this would be the confirmation of the out of Africa hypothesis. It would be that peoples from Europe, modern day Homo sapiens, would share more overlapping genetics with Neanderthals than would peoples of Africa. First step, though, is actually getting the DNA. And this was not easy. This was a big 25-year style thing. Usual DNA like we did in lab, you just got piles of it, tons. That Chelex is really rough stuff, but it produces plenty of DNA. Going into bone and frozen tissue samples that we can find in Europe, because a lot of those areas are like a little colder, they can preserve things better. You can find pockets of DNA, tiny though. Here's a problem too. You got fungus on there, you got bacteria on there. So you got to filter out both of those sequences every time. You also got to anticipate that certain chemical changes happen over time to DNA. So your algorithm had to build in that a C sometimes will actually look like a C triple methylated or something, right? There were a lot of steps to make this an accurate read. Now, the first breakthrough was that mitochondrial DNA was found, and the whole plasmid, their whole little mitochondrial genome was sequenced, and this was a huge deal. This was the first time this had happened. This is why mitochondrial DNA became the first ancestry breakthrough for all of us, too, because we now had an outgroup. Neanderthal mitochondrial DNA and Homo sapien. We saw the differences for the first time. This is where that idea of the first Homo sapien mitochondrial to pass down. This is the first time that we could confirm that there were significant differences with Homo sapiens than there were with Neanderthals in that ancestry pool. What we also found is that Neanderthals, after they spread and after they had migrated, remember this is happening over thousands of years and I'm summarizing it in a couple sentences. Neanderthals lived in groups of, you know, kind of small, maybe 100 at a time. They didn't go very far from that point. So, although they're really genetically diverse groups, they did not have a lot of gene flow between groups, at least. Now, the total population had great genetic diversity, but in those pockets, typically was sort of just more of a, like a family unit, to be honest. And yeah, I know that sounds kind of messed up, but hey, you're not gonna trust anybody out in this world, I suppose. Little gene flow. You can still have diversity in that case. Now comes the big one. When we sequenced the Neanderthal genome, we started finding human DNA regions that we thought were Homo sapien regions. And we're like, oh no, we contaminated the Neanderthal DNA. Repeat the test over and over again. What we found was that we carry plenty of Neanderthal genes that evolved in that species that now carried into us equally. We found that there were genes found in Denisovan DNA that were primarily found and enriched in populations in Asia, specifically Tibet. And why this phylogeny is important, again, just on the genetic level, is look at the horizontal transfer of genetic information all over the place. We even have a Denisovan set of bones that we found was a hybrid with a Denisovan and a Neanderthal. That's what that one right there was. Or at least that there were contact points. And it was very funny. So Paavo Svado, the main scientist, the Swedish guy that did all this, he was like, well, like, you know, here's our conclusion. There's Neanderthal DNA in all of us. There was intermixing when the first time Homo sapiens came out, the next time. And a lot of wives would send in their husband and DNA and say, like, I think my husband's a Neanderthal, sequence him. He's really rude and bullish and oafish. It's kind of a sad characterization of Neanderthals because they, I mean, think about it, they're surviving a long time. They're pretty good. But these complete genomes unlocked a story. And that's what you can see here is that in that spread as Homo sapiens went forth, there was a lot of contact. And genes can tell that story. Yeah, and by contact, I mean a lot of sex. Sorry, that's what the book says. That's what it said to tell you guys. So this is another good little summary here of how many events that we can predict based on massive numbers of sequencing. Now, again, you don't need to know the percentages here, obviously. This is mainly red text for what horizontal gene transfer means. And what this shows is that in this early crossing of Homo sapiens, right here, there was an immediate contribution of Neanderthal genetics. Later, when these same migrants made it to Asia and Oceania, they encountered Denisovans, and there was intermixing there. So you can follow this story. So if you're European, you likely have very little or no Denisovan DNA. If you're from Asia or Oceania, you likely have very little Neanderthal DNA. If you're from Africa, you never got that intermixing never happened because population stayed as well. So the genome did confirm, I mean, for all intents and purposes, the out of Africa hypothesis, but it also told this very interesting story of interaction. One of the genes that comes along with Neanderthal genes is associated with type 2 diabetes. Shit, oops. SCL16A11, it is a sugar storage gene. Uh-oh, Europeans got plenty of these. Nobody else. Dang it. Why would you evolve something that makes you fat? Well, if you live in the winter in Europe during glacial periods of like nothing's around, no crops, no nothing. And remember, you're not growing crops at this point. You're just hunting and gathering a little bit. So the environment really dictates your survival. So only those that could store enough energy to survive that winter could survive. So Neanderthals are enriched for this gene. The key regions that are changed between our version and the Neanderthal version are highlighted in red. These changes allow this receptor to be more active. Another key one. I told you about immunogenetics, right? Toll-like receptors that make you immune to certain genes, right? When the peoples that would become Neanderthals or Denisovans ventured forth, they encountered new diseases, new animals, new issues. And the evolution of a lot of toll-like receptors showed up, specifically 7, 9, and 10, I believe. Oh my God, 9's not on there. Oh yeah, there is. Because as populations move, they encounter new diseases. And this was strict Mendelian evolution here. These are real life, either copies or versions of our old TLRIs that were modified to fight new pathogen. Now remember, this isn't just happening like X-Men. This is thousands of years. thousands of generations that die because they don't have these, and only the ones that did would survive. So that's why, typically, geographically, wherever your ancestry is from, you will likely have the immune tools to kill whatever pathogen is native to that area as well, because your surviving ancestors had to live to have that happen. Okay, break time, good dogs. Didn't smile very often. All right. Nobody here is like gonna get, has everybody here, if they wanted to watch the Marvel movies, they've already watched them, right? Like spoilers, is it okay? All right, get out if you haven't, if you don't want to see some spoilers, I guess, or cover your ears. All right, that's okay. You guys, yeah, see, it's my masterpiece, my final. Possible. Yeah. I hope you guys have a great one. Yes.
I am inevitable.
Yes. Just like Travis. Oh. No, see, you have the power to do it all. Well, you know. Yay!
And I am Iron Man.
Right. We're done. No more genetics, no more Punnett squares, no more DNA. Yay. See, that was a good one. That was happy for everybody. Good dog. So. Yeah, now I'm only gonna make happy ones. The class average was scary, you guys laughed at that too much, but like, hey, come on, Travis can do it. I can maybe reach that level, right? No. All right, well, I know it's not, that's the point. That's the point of the office hours and the reviews. All right, so today, oh no, I turned the lights off on everybody. Today, about, let's say, the average person in the room will have about 1 or 2% your coding genome is some Neanderthal contribution. Pretty neat. Now, if you just like amalgamized and combined all of those little contributions, still have about 40% of the complete Neanderthal genome that we have sequenced from the bones and the tissue. So pretty fun, pretty interesting to find that. If not a little, you know, interesting and uncomfortable to say the least, that's okay. And even new genomics has been able to find more hominid populations that were alive around the same time. Now, one note to mention here about ancient tissue and DNA. We will find more of it in regions that are colder. That's just the nature of how physics works. If you go into a region that's more hot, you've degraded most of the tissue in a few seasons, right? It's not gonna last as easy. That's why it is always gonna be easier. You always hear more about areas where we find, oh, in some cold, dark cave in France, we found more bones and tissue, hooray, right? It's just a natural consequence of tissue. Now we were lucky to find Denisovan DNA because look at the regions that they're from, pretty hot regions, right? Some of the regions that we found, even today, have either a small contribution or a pretty massive contribution depending on geographic ancestry. So Denisovans, more in green towards the right, that was their sort of stomping ground back in the day before the Homo sapien cross. And you can see today in the red, that's how much Homo sapiens in those regions today share Denisovan DNA. All right, if we consider the blue sort of the Neanderthal region and red the Denisovan region, this also sort of outlines the path of Homo sapien contact as well. We'll get into that migration in a couple slides here. The exclamation points are regions of contact that are surmised based on either archaeological finds or certain genomics events that will then splinter in the populations. The green is that Neanderthal and Denisovan hybrid that I talked about. We're likely plenty since there's an entire border right there. It's the only one we've ever found. So the main Denisovan contribution is an EPAS1 variant. It's a gene that allows oxygen efficiency at high altitude. Peoples of Tibet have that gene. It evolved in Denisovans that first occupied that region. Peoples of Tibet are ancestors of the Homo sapiens that would then occupy that region. They are highly, highly enriched for that really good effective variant. When you have something that's key to survival in a region, you'll see it show up over time. Humans are no different than a lot of animals in that way. So here was the other thing that we found. Humans, as far as mammals go, we are not very genetically diverse, not by a long shot. So at the beginning of this story in the spread that you see in red here, remember that there are hominid species running around. There's Erectus, there's Denisovan, there's Neanderthal, there's a couple others. Homo sapiens are us. The reason that we are not very genetically diverse is that the story goes and the archaeological finds go that there was one area in East Africa and Namibia with signs of a large group of Homo sapiens being around in the same spot. And this would be the birth of the Homo sapiens, as we would call it, because once they settled in one spot, there was no more genetic flow anymore. That was the birth of us, basically. And that's why peoples from this region, we still to this day see that L0 mitochondrial haplotype, the original, the first one, the one that's shared mostly with everybody. Second, why are we not incredibly diverse as a species? The crossings, number two. So Homo sapiens did, from that original civilization, from that original group of cooperation, they overtook all of Africa eventually. Eventually there were crossings, cross Fertile Crescent, second time. Remember the Neanderthals and Denisovan ancestor had done it before, but it's a hard crossing, okay? It's theorized that based on genomics, based on subgroups, There were only three crossings that ever happened, successful ones. Because at this stage, geographically, you had to cross a lot of canals, things like that. It's not just, you know, walking across the beach. The third crossing, which was, the first crossing is theorized to have actually failed because Neanderthals lived in that region and they didn't much like us. Now, the second two crossings would be successful, but you have to remember, even if that's only 5,000, 2,000 peoples, Homo sapiens, and then everything comes from that, that's what we call a bottleneck in evolution. So that's why paying attention to disease and stuff is very important, because if humans do go down for a certain disease, it's going to get most of us. So two crossings happen. It's only a few people, you know, in the context of it. So carrying on in the genetic story, we started to say, all right, we must be epigenetically different than these things. So all the promoter regions, the little splice regions, the enhancers. And actually what you're looking at is that we didn't have that many differences there, at least not in the coding promoter style regions. These regions are highly divergent in the primate cousins. What this tells us is that Neanderthals, Denisovans, any upright bipedal primate like us had already made all those epigenetic changes to have whatever plasticity in our brain was necessary to be problem solving the way we are. So we're not quite different with Neanderthals. And one of the other things with here, we started to find they're quite similar to us, so much so that it's very hard to consider them, you know, as apish as we want to. Okay, what's the other thing we can tell from genomics? What genes are different in humans than Neanderthals? Than Homo sapiens. What are the genes that make us the unique one? Why did we win? What you're looking at are three genes that control mitosis. But mitosis and neurons. The red text here is for, you can use genes to say, all right, we actually just want to find what's just special about this species right here. These are three examples of that. They regulate neuron mitosis in a way that contributes to our brain's ability to change quickly and to make new connections and to make new neurons. Other mammals don't have as active versions of these genes. Remember this goofy RNA that I showed you before? We call this human accelerated region HAR1 because it is not found in Neanderthals, it's not found in chimps or bonobos or any other primate. The areas that are not red are changes that we have. There's 18 total changes in this little RNA and they make it fold into a very unique shape. This shape serves as a transcription factor across the brain. This shape is unique and binds promoters in ways that no other animal on the planet combined, which with such speed and specificity that if you wanted to look at one gene that makes us different, it's this strange thing here. It's an RNA, it doesn't even make protein in the end. Now, the other thing with us that goes a little bit beyond some of the other genes, who's ever heard of myelin sheath before, right? It's the stuff that insulates action potential. Those of you who've taken phys should be scared by that term, obviously, right? Terrifying. Now, myelination in most species is pretty static. It doesn't change much. Humans, you can thicken myelination. You can remove it. You can make spacers. All these little things can change in humans. This is what it means to have a plastic brain, something that can change very quickly. It's a massive advantage. Takes investment, obviously, like we talked about. But the changes here are genes, honestly, that usually manipulate this process somehow. Another one. Who's ever heard of FOXP2 before? Language gene, quote unquote. You knock this genes out of birds, they lose their songbirds. You knock this gene out of mammals, they scramble in their communication. Humans without this gene or a variant of mutation of it have a very difficult time communicating at all. So the variant we have is the one theoretically that set the stage for it. Set the stage for our brain to be able to understand language as something. And that seems like a given for what we are now. Now, the argument against the genetic version of language is the fact that, like, if somebody had a FOXP2 mutant, who'd they talk to? Couldn't just be just one. There had to be some other advantage with it that spread throughout the populations. And then eventually you were able to coordinate in a way that was more organized than anything else on the planet. So revisiting here, remember on the exam, all I can really do is say, probably give you a list of stuff and you got to find the one that's not possible to know on this. I think one of the practices is, like, you know, one thing to keep in mind here, this is all a DNA thing that we're doing today. RNA will die in like 2 hours just on its own. We have no RNA. We have no idea which genes were, you know, highly expressed in Neanderthals or which ones weren't. We can only infer based on the DNA regions. So, there's the track, there's the story. We still have to confront one question. When this story started, when Homo sapiens began, there was some sort of advantage that allowed them to just erase everything else in their path, across Africa and then through the two migrations. So as Homo sapiens showed up, all the remaining Homo erectus are killed. One of the subspecies in Northern Africa, gone. There's a small species, subspecies of humans in Indonesia and on these islands. They were dead too. Denisovans, all dead. Neanderthals, all dead. So we can't go back in time and know what happened. Can only infer based on culture, based on some archaeological stuff, but sort of a story that tells itself, right? We're not exactly the most friendly things on the planet. Equally, one of the other things that happened here is 90% of any large mammal that showed up, dead. So it's a hunting question, but it's also mainly like, hey, there's not enough food. You guys are in our way. I don't know. Now, remember, this is thousands of years, millenniums occurring right now, you know? So there was intermixing, there was probably cooperation, there was all that for a while, but there was some advantage with Homo sapiens that the others, they didn't have it. So, always a fun quote to break on. Not a little grim. Very odd thing to consider, I imagine. And it shouldn't dehumanize you. You shouldn't feel worse, I mean, about it. I mean, this is already, well, I don't know. You can actually feel however you want about it, but it is a what if, you know, it is a strange, if some of them would have lasted longer, how would that have been? I don't know. It's a strange thing. So, more story time than anything. There will be applications that you can make sense of, but I want to finish this story. So, it's some green text, and I'll try and be efficient, but I imagine you're somewhat interested, I hope. I was when I first read this. So, when Homo sapiens showed up, they came up across Neanderthals. Neanderthals are bigger, they have more muscle. Genetically, they were just, quote unquote, stronger. That's because they didn't have ranged weapons. When they had to take down a woolly rhinoceros, they had to kill it by hand. So you can imagine when Homo sapiens show up and we're like, hey, give us your land, you kick the shit out of them first time, usually. Not a good time. Look at this thing. God. Sapiens had mastered ranged weapons. There was an advantage there, not just in hunting. One other thing. Yeah, of course he'd say dogs. But can you imagine having just like, and I know for now, like dogs to us now seem so friendly and nice, but can you imagine a lion coming up with you and being like, you're really not gonna leave right now? Get him. And you got like 10 or 12 dogs following, you know, this like this migrating party. And the dogs listen and the dogs are smart. The dogs still have wolf tendencies. Remember in Jurassic Park when the raptors all surround everything? Ugh, scary. Can you imagine fighting a pack of wolves? Terrifying. One of the hypotheses goes that if our dates are to be crossed together correctly, that the reason the migration started to actually win was because it lines up right when we domesticated dogs. And, you know, I use the word dog, but trust me, these are very, very big, big predator wolves at this point that are just kind of cooperating with us. But imagine having this massive asymmetric warfare style advantage or a hunting advantage too. It doesn't mean everybody had to get killed or anything, but man, we ate a lot. So last one, and this is the one that you're gonna have to consider with me, all the biology we've learned in this class. It's gonna be mainly epigenetic. It's gonna be a little development-y, don't worry. First, we've gotta consider a couple things. Evolution has constraints. There are certain ways that when a species evolves and it takes a trait, it leaves behind something else. When you take certain steps in evolution, you can't go back. There are certain things about a seahorse that mean it can never go back to the swimming style of fish that it used to be. And a more ridiculous example, a jellyfish cannot sprout a spine and walk. It's not gonna happen. The only way that you would have new chordates, for example, spines, would be ones that are at least close to that. Because when you take on a new trait that allows you to be much, you know, pretty nice in the ocean, you will lose behind most of what makes you good on land. And like I said, this is a ridiculous example. So, mammals have something. And you have to remember with dinosaurs around, mammals were at a severe disadvantage, hiding in little holes. Every niche environmentally was filled by dinosaurs. Then came the meteor and subsequent disease and fungi. And suddenly the entire world is open to these small little fur creatures. This chance change allowed for this setup to happen. The main one, big ones are gonna be here. Warm-blooded creatures that we constantly are investing energy to be this hot all the time. It's the only way you can have a big brain because it's gotta be going all the time. Can't just be when the sun's out. Next, massive parental investment. That means groups are better. That means you have a social learning aspect to a lot of mammals. Oops, I just crossed it out. Now, cognition is one thing, but emotion's a far different evolutionary tool in animals. Emotion's what makes a herd of buffalo gear up around their injured or their young. Emotion is what makes an orca teach her young how to hunt and defend her young from sharks or other things, right? But the inherent biological structures that made mammals allowed for something that is not allowed by any other type of animal. Was that low stress phenotype? Was that cooperation phenotype? So we've seen this before. We saw some of the features, right? Coat variations, skeletal changes. Some anatomical differences were a consequence of pedomorphism, right? Where you come out kind of like a kit fox, then you do an angry adult. Who thinks they know what species I'm about to talk about here? Yeah, maybe a little bit. Okay. Here comes one last hypothesis that you can build on since you have the tools, because I've given you them, hopefully. Homo sapiens. Homo sapiens hypothesized to showcase a domesticated phenotype compared to our last common ancestors and compared to our current outgroup cousins. Domestication means something very different than what you think about a livestock. It means cooperation, it means low stress. Does anybody in here feel in danger right now? No, fine. Even though you're sitting with maybe 70 of the most dangerous animals on the planet, our fear response is so far tamped down to each other that it allows us to come into contact like this in groups and coordinate. Mammals do have packs and they do have groups, but it breaks down at about 100 or 150. Family ties start breaking down. People don't trust each other. Somebody gets pissed. Neanderthals had this issue. That's why they were in those little pockets all over. The key that made the civilization in Namibia, the big one, and why Homo sapiens sprang from that, it was the first time that a mammal group broke this. Thousands of Homo sapiens in the same spot, coordinating, working together, because that fear response was so low to each other. Because it used to be big. Neanderthal groups that would find each other, they'd kill each other. They didn't like it. No, I'm not calling y'all dogs. But that low stress pathway changes what we looked like compared to what Neanderthals looked like. Our features are less pronounced than the other primate models or the other hominid models. And we won not because we're smart, it's because we're social. It's because we can tolerate together. We can strategize, we can think, we can work together to have a bigger idea. And one of the funny things is that to build culture, gossip's actually a pretty big one. So all those shitty shows that you see, that's actually just kind of our instinct. Gossip and moving together, that's one of the keys to starting social stuff. You see it sometimes happen in chimps and bonobos. It's scheming, strategy, everything else. It led to one other thing. Intersubjectivity, it's a big word. But what it means is that we were the first hominid species, and we're definitely the first animal to do it. Intersubjectivity means knowing something that is not tangible. Uniting around something that is not something you can't measure. The first of this was on the upper left, that's animism. The first idea that a spirit exists in all the living things of the world. People got impatient and they started saying, well, what if we pray to a bunch of gods that aren't alive? Rain, oceans, things like that. That sounds good. Each of these things is uniting as well. This can bring us past that 150 group when there is a central goal, a central idea that we believe in. Now, I'm not disparaging anything. This is culture. This is real. So some people in the Middle East got the idea, well, we're going to skip the line and not pray to all these hundreds of gods. That's annoying. We're going to pray to the universe itself. Just one. As humans kept going, we started to say, well, a man can be God. A woman can be God. And the main intersubjective thing we see today are ideals. You can't measure justice, can you? But it exists for all of us. You can't measure currency. Technically, well, yeah, you guys might think you can, but just technically it doesn't have any tangible like issue value, the literal paper, right? But in our minds and in our culture and in our hearts and all these things, they're real. That's the talent. We once tried to deify DNA, but that's what the eugenicists did and that didn't work out. So that's why it's last. So interesting. I always like bringing this up because the first time I finished my book on this, I was like, you gotta be kidding me. Now, it's in hypothesis territory. It's the idea that when I showed you the bonobos versus the chimps and how bonobos are way more cooperative, the idea is that last common ancestor was very likely very violent, brawny sort of chimp-like thing, but that calming down and allowing groups to form, that was the key. This is also the key why Homo sapiens swept through everything they went through. They could coordinate strategy and thinking ahead. That's intersubjective. It doesn't exist yet, does it? But if a Neanderthal band beat back a Homo sapien band the first time, they'd come back and they'd win the second time because they'd learn, they'd figure something out. So, interesting to say the least. You surprise all the stuff you can unlock with genetics and things like that. Okay, so we have some time, but more philosophizing. Hooray, what's next for us? And I've shared this with you guys before. You guys have heard like Fermi paradox, right? That like might be the only things in the universe. All said, I mean, there's no evidence that anything else is out there. So if we're life's only shot, that weight bears a lot more responsibility than you'd think. And as we start to get ideas of creating things and making something, always remember, we don't really treat our creations super duper well. So don't be surprised if when we make like an AI or something, it gets very angry at us. All right, so let's go some more lighthearted. This is an optional poll everywhere. I just want to see where everybody's allegiances lie. I always do this. Who, choose your fighter, scout or cannon. I want to know, hands on the line, who you want, who's better. I know this is kind of mean, but like, Scout had a unfortunate diarrhea attack the other day and I'm still mad at her. She had two outside times and she rudely said no. Yeah. It's happening again. Cannon's just sweeping her. I feel bad. Also, I could use this as a control group and see if whose people's test scores are higher. No, it's okay. What I said is the control group. It doesn't matter. It shouldn't. And if there's a significant change in the exam results, I don't know. Plus, I like, come on, Cannon's like my dog anyway. So I'm flexing on my wife here. Oh God, it's kidding. It's a landslide, oh no. Well, that's what you get for being a little shit, Scout. Sorry. Oh, what? No. Well, oh, some of the other districts are getting their votes. You guys are switching your votes, aren't you? I knew it. Some of the ballots are coming in. No, they're both cute dogs. They're good. Cannon's just a good dog. He doesn't misbehave. All right, that's enough. Good dogs, hooray. I know, Cannon wins by a decent long shot right there. All right. Good dogs, hooray, it's okay. So, given that, and given today that today was kind of like some, I don't know, application. I mean, you'll see a question about a phylogeny on the test. I'm probably lazy enough, I'll use that phylogeny we use today. We'll see. But 3 points. And then on Thursday, what I did with the final 13 class points was, you guys are sick of doing the writings, I get it, we're done. Three today, I want you to just give me an answer to a kind of a bigger set of questions that I have. You get to choose one and kind of go after it. On Thursday, we may have the time. I'll try. I mean, I think we should have the time. Y'all asked for a quiz and you're getting it. Oh, boo. If you boo me enough. Boo. Yeah. Screw you guys. No, I'm kidding. All right, so you guys can take it as many times as you want, though. But that first time will give me the data to say, oh, good Lord, I need to do epigenetics with everybody again. It'll be diagnostic, but it'll be all the points that are worse. So just retake it until you get it. Like, don't mash the button, but, you know, try. but that first round will give me some good data on where everybody's at. We'll probably hopefully do it live in here the first time. It'll be on D2L so I can be equitable, but et cetera. All right, so kind of end of the class, I wanted to give all these kind of options for some like kind of bigger response questions. And this is your last little response question. Did I hear some yays just now? That was terrible. How dare you? Oh, that's a lot. So you can go ahead and choose one, whichever you feel like is the easiest for you to answer. And, no nanobots. All right, I'm out of paper. I'm sorry, guys. No nanobots. It was embarrassing to get the mixed paper. I go in the recycle bin in the bio department and Professor Anderson came in to me dumpster diving in the recycling. I was like, no, it's for class. So big questions that I can't ask on the exam, but I think the thinking and the learning's worth it. There will be an open D2L for this as well because I will send you back to try again if there's very little effort or thought put into this, please. I have an outline for you. 3 pieces of evidence. It's worth 3 points. Easy, right? Fun. If you are brave and want to make your own question to answer, you can, but do be ready for me to be like, that's terrible. Revise. Be all Gordon Ramsay on you, like I said. I didn't include a behavioral genetics one just because I thought there was going to be too much gray area to like have 3 pieces of evidence. Why? But if you feel strongly about an issue, then go for it. It's the worst that can happen.